Hello. Welcome back to the lecture sessions on transmission and distribution. This is Professor Uma Rao from RV College of Engineering, bringing you the lectures under the eShikshana program of VTU. So in my previous session, I had introduced you to the different materials that are commonly used in insulators. So these are predominantly porcelain, glass, and polymer insulators. And we saw what are some of the properties which the insulators should have. So in this class, we will study about different types of insulators in brief. So the major type of insulators are pin type, suspension type, strain type, post insulator, stray insulators, and shackle insulators. So we will see what each one of them are. So the pin type insulator is as follows. I'm sure all of you would have seen this kind of insulators on the roads, on your overhead lines. So there is a groove on the top. Can you see this groove? Right? So this groove is where the conductor will be. See, the conductor will be placed like that through the groove. And these are called as petticoats. These are called as petticoats. Okay? And then at the end, you will have a galvanized steel pin. So this is the actual image. And this figure shows you how the pin insulator is fabricated. So these consist of the pin insulators consist of single or multiple armor type structures. They are connected in parallel and they are ascended on a cross arm of the pole. So on the pole, you will see that there are cross arms. So they will be mounted on that. They'll be mounted on that. So what is the function of these petticoats? You can see that these have a bigger diameter. So if there is some water or something falling on it, so it will taper off. So you see, let us say it is raining. So when it rains, what happens? It will fall on this and then it will slide and it will fall off. So this inner surface is kept dry, even though the outer surface is wet. So this is, you know, if everything gets wet, then it may reduce the leakage resistance. So this design is to ensure that the leakage resistance is sufficient to prevent any leakage currents. Then we have, why is it called as a pin type? Because there is a pin or a bolt that is used to clamp the insulator to the cross arm of the pole. And this is very economical for low voltages and becomes expensive as the voltages are higher. So normally, pin type insulators are used up to 33 kV. Okay. And they can be of one piece, two piece, or four piece. Different designs are there. And if the voltage is greater than 33 kV, the pin type insulator becomes very bulky and is no longer economical. It is not economical. So for voltages beyond 33 kV and up to 66 kV, you can use three or four pieces you can use. The advantage of the pin type is that it is simple and it supports the line conductors very efficiently and it is compact. The size is compact. So the disadvantage is that it becomes very expensive for higher voltages. Next, we have suspension type insulators. These are used for voltage levels above 33 kV. So in suspension type insulators, you have discs. This is also very common. When you see the picture next, you will recognize, you have seen it very often. So here what happens, I have identical discs. So if I want more insulation, if I want to increase the insulation level, I simply add more number of discs. So it is sort of modular. It is sort of modular. Okay. So on one end, one, it's suspension, it is suspended. So at the bottom end, it supports the conductor. It supports the conductor. And on the top end, it is connected to the cross arms. It is connected to the cross arms of the supporting structure. And this discs have to be designed. We will see how we are going to design the string in the next slides. And these type of insulators also provide partial protection against lightning when used in conjunction with the steel towers. Since the conductors run below the earthed cross arm, so I told you, it is, see, the top end is suspended from the cross arm and the conductor is housed at the bottom end, supported by the bottom end. So if a lightning strikes, it will strike the cross arm, and the cross arm would have been grounded, so the conductor is protected. So it does provide partial protection against lightning. And compared to pin insulators, these are more expensive. See, you would have seen all these are suspension insulators. So I have different number of discs. So this is one with three discs. This is one with 8 discs. So if I want a higher level of voltage, I can simply go on adding the discs. So the top portion is supported by the cross arm of the pole, and the bottom portion here, this will carry the conductor. Okay, this will carry the conductor. Next, I have strain type insulators. These are similar to suspension type. Only thing is, they are mounted horizontally. And to withstand the pull of a suspended electrical wire or cable. It's like providing the horizontal support to hold the wires. So they are used to either support radio antennas or overhead power lines. And they're also used, you know, when the wire or the line is subjected to great tensions. For example, in a dead end, or when there's a sharp bend, you know, there's a lot of tension around the conductor when there is a bend. So in such places, they're similar to suspension insulators. They have discs, but they're mounted horizontally. And they are basically used to minimize tension. So we saw when we discussed SAG, that tension is one parameter which may, you know, damage the conductor. So we have to be careful about that. So this will minimize excessive tension on the line. And when the tension is very high in the conductor, we can use two or more strings in parallel. Tension is tightness. See like this. So you see, if you look at this, this is similar to a suspension type. Only thing is, it is mounted horizontally. So this will minimize the tension of this lines. Okay. So it is designed again with porcelain or glass or fiberglass. And it includes the supporting hardware and the two cables to join it. And the other names for this are shackle type and tension type. These are the other names for the strain insulators. Now, let's see a short video on how there can be a flashover over an insulator. Just keep watching it. You'll see the flashover. Right? So now, when we studied about the materials used in the insulators, we saw that it must withstand the flashover. So you saw, no, that there's a flashover over the insulator. So that material should be robust. It should not melt or get excessively heated up or cause a flashover to the ground. Now, this is another very interesting video where you can see the effect of flashovers on the distribution side. So when we discussed in the first lecture, we saw distribution side is all low voltage side where it comes directly to the consumer. So these are all distribution wires. And just watch this short video and see how damaging faults can be. See, It can cause fires. The flashovers can cause fires. And many forest fires are caused because of flashovers between the conductor and the ground. Look at this. The whole insulator is burning. This, there is a flashover from the ground. And look at these birds. How detrimental they can be. They cause so much of a problem. This is a transformer burst. So there is a spillage. There's a spillage on the ground because of which the arc is coming up from the ground. Look at this. How the flashovers are there between the lines. This can damage the insulator. This can damage the insulator. Can you see it? Yeah, see here? The whole wire is burning. It got snapped and it can lead to major fires. These are all lightning strikes under adverse weather conditions. Yeah. This is also the transformer burning. Look at the flashovers. Look at this. Very common. Very, just see. The pole structure itself collapsed because of the wind. Because of the wind. And now see, the entire thing is burning. Okay. So I came across this video and I thought it would be very good so that you can see firsthand what happens. Okay. And so this lecture was only to show you the different types of insulators and the design of the discs we will see in the next lecture. And you can see, I showed you so many faults. So you can see the impact of the faults. It can be really detrimental. It can be fatal. It can cause a lot of damage. So thank you. We will continue with the design in the next class.